let's start with today's session on machine learning, and the topic for today is support vector machines. And support vector machines will be the first class of methods that is used explicitly for classification. And we will discuss three other classification methods of the support vector machines, namely linear discriminant analysis, logistic regression, and neural networks. And all of them are employed in the analysis of fMRI and EEG data to essentially, you can view it from two perspectives, predict what people were engaging with. So when the new physiological data was recorded, so some form of brain reading. If you are a little bit more down to earth, you would say they are used as very indirect measures to measure the statistical association between experimental conditions and multivariate neurophysiological signals. The plan for today is to first discuss a little bit the application of these methods to fMRI data in particular. So for all of you scan people, of whom there are like two, to have motivation in terms of the analysis of brain imaging data. And once we have achieved that, then we are going deeper into the specific methods class that we are interested in today, namely support vector machines. And there we first going to discuss some basic geometric features which are important, and then we will discuss the topic of support vector machine training, which corresponds to parameter estimation essentially in support vector machines. And then we're going to, in a more technical session, look at the quadratic program formulation of SVM training, which is quite helpful from a practical perspective if you would like to implement your own support vector machine with the help of a general purpose quadratic program algorithm toolbox. And finally, we are going to look a little bit into what else is related to support vector machines in a very brief part on kernelizing the maximum margin SVM, because kernel methods are also something that you will find in machine learning, at least the term. And this is also related to this quadratic program formulation, so that's where we are going to end. Okay, that's the rough plan, so let's start with the introduction. These slides, so the next couple of slides with these beautiful pictures, they come from John Dylan Haynes' review or primer in Neuron on fMRI pattern classification analysis, or multivoxel pattern analysis, as we already encountered it in the first session. That's a very nice review, very nice primer, so I highly recommend to read that. You will also get a feeling of what cognitive neuroscientists and fMRI people and EEG people are interested in terms of machine learning classification methods, and also what they are not interested in, namely what we are going to do today. So the things that happen under the hood, that's usually something that cognitive neuroscientists don't talk much about, but of course, to understand what's really happening, we of course have to look into essentially the toolboxes that are being used by fMRI and EEG data analysis people. Good, so what's the story here? It's again the MVPA story, like we did in the first session, but now with a little bit more detail. So the idea is that the human participants whose brain data is being recorded, and this is now specifically discussed for fMRI data, where you acquire one image of the brain every 2 seconds, and this image of the brain consists of voxels, which are these blocks here, and the gray value of these voxels relates to the bold signal, so the essentially the read of neural activation by means of metabolic transforms. And the idea here is that, and the example that tries to explain what fMRI pattern analysis or multivoxel pattern analysis is that the participant either views images of cats or images of dogs. And while these images are presented to the participant, fMRI data is acquired, and these fMRI data form, because they comprise voxels, which you can of course not only arrange in this 3D grid that covers the brain, but also as a long list of all voxel activations, they can be viewed as forming a pattern vector. What the specific activation levels in terms of time and the specific voxel sets in terms of space are, we're going to look at in a second. For now, we in this graph, the idea is to introduce this idea of pattern classification, and that's easiest to do if you don't consider like a 100-dimensional pattern vector or fMRI activation vector, but only a 2-dimensional vector, because then you can nicely visualize that and plot it in 2D. And so what is plotted here are the first two voxels, so these two voxels here, which are also highlighted here. And here's an example, a very simple example. If we look at the value of voxel 1, then the idea is that for images of cats, the values of voxel 1 kind of spread around here. Maybe if you put some axis here, then you would have your 0 here, and here you would have some non-zero values, for example 5 or so. I think I have to close my window because somebody is making loud noises outside. Just a second. So that's a little bit better. And so that's voxel 1. So voxel 1 shows some non-zero activation for cats, while voxel 2 doesn't show that. So the values of voxel 2 are basically around 0 for the images of cats. For the images of dogs, the story is reversed. So voxel 1 basically does not very much and stays around 0 here. Of course, it would be nice if the 0 would actually be put here. I mean, it can also be some non-zero value. Maybe it's a little bit activated just due to the visual input, but it's definitely not as much activated now voxel 1 as for the images of cats. The story is different for voxel 2. So voxel 2 is activated. And that's a typical kind of, if you want, univariate pattern, or the idea of what's also behind GLM analysis. So you assume that certain parts of the brain are activated for certain categories, while they are not activated for other categories. And then you would have some functional specificity or functional segregation. And of course, this kind of activation pattern for these two voxels, you would be able to, of course, detect readily with a univariate method. So this is shown again here. Now the story of motivating MVPA is that this kind of pattern can be easily distinguished based on, or this kind of specialization can be easily distinguished based on univariate signals. However, if the activation pattern of the voxels is a little bit more elaborate, then specifically the marginal distributions that you see here don't readily distinguish between the cases, although that's yeah, one can discuss that a little bit, but the idea is that you don't have this clear-cut activation of just one voxel and the other voxel, but you have activation of both voxels for both categories. However, if you look here and consider that the red ones are the activations for cats while the green ones are the activations for dogs, you see that for cats the first voxel is always more activated than the second voxel, so you are always somehow shifted here to the right, while for the for dogs the first voxel is always more activated than the second, while for dogs the second voxel, so the one that you have on the y-axis, is always more activated than the one for cats. And then the idea is that these kind of patterns in voxel activations, although they might not be that easily discernible and statistically significant in terms of univariate activations, can still be read out from the pattern activity of the voxels by, for example, establishing a linear discriminant function that says if the voxel activation is to the left, so up here, then it's more likely that a dog was shown, whereas if it's down here where it's red, then it's more likely that a cat was shown. And of course one can come up with more complex ideas of voxel activation patterns as shown here, so that there's kind of this weird kind of split of the voxel activation space in 2D, where certain patches are associated with the cat activation, and then neighboring patches are associated with the dog activation. So I think no one has ever really observed something like this empirically, but it's an argument that based on the marginal distribution it might be really hard to distinguish what's going on here, whereas it's really easy to distinguish what's going on here, because here voxel 1 is clearly more active for cats and not really active for dogs, and the other way around for voxel 2, which is clearly more active for dogs and little active for cats. And here the individual voxel activation patterns are really not very meaningful. But if you look at the 2D representation of these two voxels, then you see that there is some structure in the activation, and the idea would be then to have a method that can recover this kind of structure in activation. We will, however, focus actually on linear separability, so these kind of cases here, this thing, or even more interesting things like that you have circular stuff, so that in the middle there would be the dog activation and around it would be the cat activation or something like this. This is where nonlinear transformations of the feature activations come into play, and this relates then to kernel methods. But actually the usual case of support vector machines is that you don't employ any kernel methods or any nonlinear transformations, but you employ linear SVMs, and then you're actually only looking essentially at linear separability, or you use soft margin classification, as we will see later. Finally, there's also a point that you don't need to do this classification, binary classification methods, but you can also do regression approaches in multi-dimensional spaces. This relates to multivariate ANOVA and things. And that's also interesting. Actually, Carsten Allefeld and John Dylan Haynes have a couple of nice papers on looking at multivariate ANOVA approaches to, if you want, brain reading. And that these are nice papers. The only disadvantage of what they are doing is that they for some reason wanted to cross-validation, and hence there's cross-validation in there, which is not really necessary. So that's the basic motivation to go from kind of univariate methods to multivariate methods, because univariate methods are very good at detecting this kind of activation, but not very good at detecting this kind of activation. Is there a question?
Yeah, hi, morning. I just have a very basic question, and it's not really relevant, so you can decide to answer or not. But so I always keep wondering, when we have these voxel, you know, relationships, etc. For example, with respect to voxel 1, with respect to voxel 2, like how do we determine that these relationships are constant, or how do we even start with the relationship between voxel 1 versus with respect to, for example, in the cat, the relationship between voxel 1 and voxel 2 activation is with respect to each other. And this may differ if we bring in another voxel 3 or another voxel 4. I don't know. Maybe I'll think about it and frame the question better.
Yeah, maybe think about it. But if you have a third voxel, of course, it's not... this is just how a voxel 1 behaves in terms of if a cat is present, and this is how voxel 2 behaves if a cat is present.
With respect to each other. This activation pattern is with respect to each other.
No, not with respect to each other. This shows what voxel 1 is doing. This shows what voxel 2 is doing. And this is not with respect to each other. This just shows both behaviors. And if you would have a third voxel, of course, this behavior of voxel 1 and this behavior of voxel 2 would not change. You would just have another dimension that you would look need to look at. So this is just the what you see here is just what is recorded in the first voxel when cats are recorded, or when dogs are presented and voxel 1 is recorded. So it's not that you somehow take the raw data and then you compute a difference or a multiply by voxel 1 and voxel 2 and then you look at this, but it's really the raw data. So it's not with respect to each other, it's just the raw data. Yeah?
Okay.
Good.
Thank you.
Then the question is, so that's the basic motivation, and then of course the classical case is that you, or one thing that is interesting to consider is that from the univariate signals you cannot distinguish between the conditions that were presented, but you can easily from the two-dimensional setting, because it's always in this case that if, let me think again, if cats are presented, then voxel 1 is more active, and if dogs are presented, then voxel 2 is more active, but the other one is always active as well, of course. So in this kind of scenario, there's a good motivation to do multivariate pattern analysis. And then the general approach that is being used based on actually the ideas of Wapnick's statistical learning theory, which I will remark upon later a little bit, is that you use a subset of the data to train a classifier, so to estimate the parameters of the classifier. That's what training means. Then you use some form of decision rule based on the output of the classifier. So after training the classifier, you can of course give it again a pattern of a pattern vector, and then based on what the classifier output says, you apply some kind of decision rule. And the idea is that you have a subset of the data that you call test data, and then you apply the decision rule, and then you get a prediction for your test data. And this prediction of the test data in terms of the condition that was presented to the participant can either be correct or incorrect, because you know the true labels, you know what kind of data you recorded, and then you will make some good predictions, so hits, but you also maybe make some false predictions, which are then not hits. Misses, I think they are called, and then you can compute classification accuracy, which is shown here, which may vary with the number of voxels. And this classification accuracy is then your measure of statistical association between the presented stimulus So the experimental condition and the activation pattern of these two voxels. It's very indirect, and I will show you in logistic regression something that I recently discovered that is can also be a little bit misleading. So yeah, it's yeah, I will come back to that when I talk about statistical learning theory briefly. I mean, one could just basically quantify this instead of doing the classifier and predicting and so on, and then having this accuracy. In any case, what is also being done, and this now without much explanation, because we don't even know what weights are yet, but you will, in the classifier, each voxel will be have an associated weight, which in a way quantifies how much it contributes to the classification decision. And these weights, you can, because there's one for each voxel, you can also overlay on brain and then make some sense of it. And there's some debate of how useful that is or not. So there are also papers on that, but people do it. So that's the basic idea of how people do this multivariate pattern analysis. As I said, I also did this like 12 years ago. It's very indirect. It's if you are interested in the statistical association. So I don't think it's a very nice approach. This is why I don't use it much anymore. But people love it, and it's being done. The question is a little bit, of course, always what is actually the data that you put in, and what are actually the so what are these activation levels, and from which voxels do you consider? And of course, you can do whatever you want in terms of fMRI. What is being done? Yeah, in terms of temporal feature selection is shown here. Of course, you can distinguish between block designs, as you know from neurocognitive methods, where you present images of cats, so multiple images of cats for prolonged periods of time, and then multiple images of dogs for prolonged periods of time. And event-related designs, but essentially what people do is relatively similar. So in the old days, we thought a little bit that block designs would be better for fMRI classification because things would be very subtle. But then these classification methods are also highly sensitive, so they're also being applied to event-related designs. So what do people do? For example, as activation patterns, they take voxel sets associated with single volumes, so single time points, while cats are being presented, maybe not the first one, but after some delay accounting for the hemodynamic response, they then take three patterns here, three patterns here, three patterns here. What they also do is that they average over blocks. I think that's what I did in the old days. We just average the volumes over block after accounting for the hemodynamic response delay, and then we had one pattern per block. So here you would have three patterns per block, and then depends how many blocks you have and how many runs you have, how you can do your cross-validation. You can do blocks. You can also estimate. Of course, you can do a GLM and try to have regressors that model individual blocks, and then estimate their parameters, and then take the parameter estimates. I think that's what people prefer a little bit these days. Because their story is that it filters out the noise. Of course, it's very similar to computing averages. And of course, you can also have a GLM that predicts the entire run time series, and then you only have one value, activation value for one run, so you can only do your cross validation run wise. So here you can obviously do your cross validation run or block wise. Here I would argue that you can also do your cross validation single volume based, so I don't think anything counts against that. If you have a event-related design. You can use single volumes. You can use the averages of single trials. You can try to set up a GLM that models individual trials. You need to look a little bit out for identifiability there, because of course these in event-related designs the trials can be fairly close together in time. Or and I think that's the most usual thing that people do these days in terms of event-related design. You take a parameter estimate from your GLM for a specific condition over the entire run, so you get a better parameter for run one that encodes how much activation there was for docs, and you take a better parameter for one run that encodes how much activations there was for cats, and then you have for each run two activation patterns, so for cats and for dogs, and then you train on the remaining runs and predict on one left out run. Yeah, so that's temporal feature selection. Multiple things are possible. Sometimes people talk a little bit much, for my taste, about dependencies, and they say, yeah, you cannot do this because there's dependency and you should not leave out, you have to do it via runs and so. That's always fairly uninformed. I mean, we had these discussions 12 years ago, and the question is, what do you mean by dependency? If you can, okay, if you say there are some dependencies, sure, but then please spell out your statistical model. Tell me about the covariance matrix that you assume that encodes these dependencies, and then let's discuss more how you can account for these covariances over time, in this case, over time in terms of your cross-validation. And if you model this covariance over time, then of course you can, and you have a good idea of it, you can also subtract it from the data, and then you can do your cross-validation without these error covariances, like we discussed for example, generalized least squares methods and variance component estimation. But this is then usually not discussed, so it's more like, yeah, but in a single run the things are all, they are correlated. And then it's like, yeah, and? So how are they correlated? Can we do something about it? What does it mean? But then the discussion is already over, and you get from the reviewer feedback, this is not possible because things are dependent on each other. Anyway, the other selection that you need to make when you apply this to fMRI data is that you need to decide what to do with the time that is given to you. That's what you always need to decide, but here you also need to decide what kind of voxels you actually select, what voxel sets you select. And there are different options and different approaches that people use. Some people use the whole brain for classification. Some people use regions of interest, for example, based on retinotopic mapping. That's what I did back in the days because we were interested in visual cortex. Some people use anatomical mass, for example, across the whole brain to decide on the regions that they use. Interesting approach here is to use use activation levels over different degrees of spatial frequencies. So this is kind of a image Fourier analysis of the fMRI data, and then you either make a prediction based on the low frequency information or make a prediction based on the high frequency information. Not sure what this means in terms of biology, but apparently it's something that people do. So these would be kind of regions of interest approaches, so whole brain, functional ROIs, anatomical ROIs, or frequency bands, and then a region of interest in the frequency, spatial frequency representation of images. The one thing that people also do is, instead of then looking at the classification accuracy from these specific regions of interest, is that they use essentially a lot of regions of interest by doing what people love to call a searchlight approach, after Nico Kriegerskorte's paper from 2006 or so in PNAS, where the idea is that you define regions of of interest again and again, and shift this regions of interest like a searchlight throughout the brain, and then take as a pattern activation always this the pattern of your current local searchlight ROI, and then also assign to that local region of interest an accuracy after doing the cross-validation, and then basically do that for every subject, and then average this over participants and maybe threshold it, and then you find the regions that have some high classification accuracy. Of course, this can be done. Of course, you need to also decide what a good searchlight size is, because you want to keep that kind of constant. I think, I don't know how far people are now finally with actually constraining this to Cortex and actually doing Cortex-based searchlight. This was always that we, like 12 years ago, thought would be a good thing to do. I mean, I mean, it's also then the question of how big you make this searchlight and whether you test all different sizes and compare and so on. But in any case, it exists. It has the benefit, I think, specifically with respect to selecting certain ROIs, that if you have only if you acquire the whole brain data and then you restrict to one ROI and you get something above chance, then of course you can make the story that this brain region somehow contributes something. But if you would look at the whole brain, you might find that most of the brain actually contributes something, and there are other regions that can even classify better, so that they have higher statistical association with your conditions. So in a way, it's a little bit fairer to do this searchlight rather than focusing here. On the other hand, if you have good reasons to focus on this, for example in vision research where you're only interested up to V5, then you may also do that. Good, and this is again the example that I already showed you previously from my own work early in my first PhD, where we, I only have one PhD, but my PhD was divided in two phases. And actually my first PhD never was allowed to be part of my PhD. Anyway, here we presented, instead of cats and dogs, we presented concentric and radial patterns and random and other random patterns, and then we looked at visual cortices, and we found that higher object-sensitive cortex, LOC, can distinguish quite nicely between concentric and radial, but not between random patterns, whereas early visual cortex doesn't make this distinction between concentric and radial patterns, but basically can classify as well as it can classify random, so basically not at all. That's one typical example. Good, so that is kind of the whole MVPA fMRI classification story. Of course, you can go more into that, and you can also apply these methods to EEG, and you can discuss how much this is brain reading and how much privacy people still have and whether there's free will with based on this. That's one thing you can do. The other thing that you can do is to say, okay, that's very interesting, but maybe I don't quite get what's actually happening here in terms of training. So what is happening here? And this is what we are going to look at for the remainder of the summer term course. So we are interested in mainly the training of classifiers, because once the classifier is trained, then of course the prediction is relatively easy. You just give it a new pattern and ask what kind of category is that based on what you have learned. So it's all about the training. And in training, for example, if you have this kind of linear separable activation pattern, scenario, the question is, what is a good classification boundary? So here you see three examples. So for example, you see this diagonal dashed line, which actually in terms of making predictions works well. So everything to the upper right is in one category, everything to the lower right is in one category. But you also see that this horizontal line achieves the same thing. So what are good parameters? What is a good classification boundary? Should I select the diagonal one or should I select the horizontal one? Maybe I shouldn't select this second almost diagonal line, because this actually makes some errors in training. But then maybe I don't want to fit the noise and do model overfitting and so on, so maybe I want to allow for some training errors. So maybe after all this is a good idea. And this actually shows the answer by an SVM. The SVM prefers to maximize what's called the margin. What that is, we will talk about. So the fundamental answers to these questions in training, so what are good classification boundaries, are for the methods that we will look at the following. So in support vector machines, large margins are preferred. And if you hear large margin, then obviously sounds something like a geometric property and not necessarily like a statistical property. And this is something that is of some importance, because the way we will talk about support vector machines, there will be no probabilities. So support vector machines will not be a probabilistic model, which is different for when we talk about linear discriminant analysis, which is a very explicit joint distribution over patterns of input patterns and associated target variables or labels or conditions. And because it's a probabilistic model, we can of course do maximum likelihood parameter estimation, same essentially for logistic regression, which we will discuss both next time. And then neural networks, again, not really involving a probabilistic model, but rather minimizing some error function in terms of training errors. So this is kind of the overview and outlook for the remainder of this course. And obviously today we're going to focus on support vector machines. Good, now we're getting closer to support vector machines. So support vector machines are essentially the work of Vladimir Vapnik, who worked in Russia and worked there throughout the late 60s, 70s and 80s, and developed a framework for essentially machine learning that is called statistical learning theory, and in this context also develop support vector machines. And the crucial thing about this is that statistical learning theory is actually different from standard statistics in that it actually emphasizes prediction much more than accurate parameter inference. So in statistics, you know that we estimate parameters and then we're interested in whether these parameters are estimated well. In statistical learning theory, you're not that interested in estimating parameters very well, but making good predictions. And that's what is emphasized in his work. And this is, of course, what then, once he came to the West after the fall of the Iron Curtain, which also was introduced more into Western computer science and statistics, and is kind of this theme that still in a way distinguishes machine learning from statistics, if you start really thinking about what should be the difference. So I think actually Vapnik's statistical learning theory, together with neural networks, are the two original things of machine learning. And the statistical learning theory by Vapnik is of course probabilistic, It's called statistical learning theory. It's just a different kind of probabilistic framework for doing inference and for doing especially prediction than classical statistics and or standard standard Western statistics, if you want. The thing is that support vector machines you can discuss without talking about statistical learning theory much. So that's what we are going to do, because otherwise we would spend much more time on this. So this statistical learning theory is a framework for finding good predictive functions based on data. Like I said, it values predictive performance higher than approximation or parameter identification accuracy, and SVMs were developed in this context. So this is kind of the historical overview. So already in the 60s, Chevronenkis and Wapnick developed maximum margin classification, what we will mainly talk about today. And then in the early 90s, Bose and Wapnick suggest kernel functions, which we'll also see a little bit. Only in 1995, then soft margin classification for SVMs was introduced, which we'll also see something. And then people who worked with Wapnick, for example, Bernhard Schülkopf, as a PhD student of Wapnick, they then in the late 1990s pushed kind of the ideas of SVMs and a little bit statistical learning theory in academia, so to make it popular. And then you would find SVM toolboxes, websites, and then of course also the Machine Learning Summer School, which led to this hype of SVM, because it was essentially a public relations campaign in the late 1990s, led to this hype in the machine learning community about SVMs in the 2000s. Like I always say, when I was in Tübingen in 2005, everything was about SVMs. But of course, the hypes come and go, and the SVM hype has gone. So since 2010, you all know the neural networks are hyped more. At one point, SVMs will come back with a vengeance, I assume, but this day has not come yet. Or somebody will somehow, although they are very similar or whatever, somehow relate a neural network to an SVM and give it a new name, support neural network, and this will be then the new thing, and everybody will love it for 3 years, and until they find, oh, it doesn't solve all the answers. Again, didn't this happen already with neural networks, which didn't solve all the problems and gave all the answers? In any case, that's the hype culture of machine learning. One remark about statistical learning theory versus classical statistics. So I think there's a the distinction, and I already mentioned that briefly in the first lecture. The distinction between making good predictions based on basically whatever estimated models and parameters versus being able to identify your models and interpret your parameters. Is of course also, from my perspective, a distinction between applied context, even if you want clinical context, and basic research or non-applied context. So I think in a clinical or an applied context, of course, prediction is very important. So if you don't care, so essentially you don't care how you heal a person, or you don't care how your model works that predicts that there will be an earthquake, as long as it predicts it very nicely and the you can also to a very high accuracy, and people get healthy, and you know when the earthquake happens so that you can evacuate people, then it really doesn't matter, and it's also not important why this works, because it's much more important that it works. So if you have clinical success, that's highly important, and it doesn't matter how you get there. If you do basic research, however, then of course the focus is on why what is happening, why are these things like that, and how what do the parameters mean, and because there the focus is not so much on the outcome but actually on the process itself, there you would be interested in actually still identifying models well Having models with parameters that you can interpret. So it's again this kind of basic research versus applied setting. So of course I see the value of good predictive modeling in applications, but I don't see that much of its value in basic research. And as I'm doing basic research, I'm more interested in the things that actually allow for good scientific inference. If I wanted to predict well, I don't know how COVID-19 is developing. Of course, it would be helpful to have a model that I don't understand and that nobody understands and that doesn't have much meaning, as long as it works. Good. So, so we will not talk about statistical learning theory. So, I put some references there, and there's some stuff in the reference folder where you can read up on that if you want. We will focus on SVM training and support vector machines for classification. We will take this cross-validation approach as given and not discuss much about the sense or nonsense behind it in fMRI. From my perspective, it's nonsense in fMRI, but we will not do that. We will basically discuss support vector machine support vector machines training mainly, and take this cross-validation as a given. We will not discuss statistical learning theory, the questions of optimality in maximum margin classification, because we will introduce maximum margin classification as a good thing, but we will not discuss why having a wide margin might be a good idea, because this, again, you can only answer by looking at how it's being used and what kind of background assumptions you make. What we will also not look at is multi-class classification, so we will always look at the binary case, so cats and dogs, but not cats and dogs and birds. And we will also not talk much about kernel methods. So if these things are really things that you want to learn about, look into the references, basically the Wapnick stuff that are put into the reference folder for kernel methods, look into the Shulkov book. Thing is, if you want to understand these things, a good starting point is to understand support vector machines the way I'm presenting them here. So of course, this whole thing is a master's course, so it's a first introduction to these kind of methods. If you want to learn more, you have the rest of your life to learn more. Good, yeah, so I already mentioned some of the references. So Haynes has this primer on pattern recognition. Then you find support vector classification methods in all standard machine learning books by Hasty, Bishop, Alperdin, Barber, Duda, and Murphy. The primary literature on support vector machine statistical learning theory I already mentioned. And finally, there's for kind of a modern perspective, a 2000s perspective on all of this, there's this book by Bernard Schulkopf and I don't remember his first name, Smoller. So both of them were PhD students of Wapnick or postdocs, not quite sure right now. So, but they were basically the people that learned support vector machines from Wapnick and then made their careers based on that. Yo, good. So that's kind of the long introduction, but it's also the introduction and the motivation for the next two sessions. So I think it was worth spending a little bit of time on that. So my suggestion then would be that we have a break now, maybe until 8:40, so 20 minutes to 9, and then get really started on support vector machines. Are there any questions right now? That doesn't seem to be the case. So let's continue at 8:40, 20 minutes to 9. Okay, then let's continue. Now the topic for the next hour is the geometry of linear discriminant functions, and the reason to discuss this is to understand how learning the parameters of a support vector machine or any machine learning technique that is based on a linear discriminant function, and support vector machines obviously are, how learning the parameters of such a model is related to the visual intuition of having this decision boundaries, and how the parameters actually can change the decision boundaries in these multi-dimensional spaces. So that's the main topic. And we will now also start to formalize the whole business of learning the parameters of a classification techniques, and introduce some basic definitions and foundations for the support vector machine model and other classification models. So we are starting with the following definition of a binary classification training data set. And we use this definition: a binary classification training data set D is a set of training examples xi and yi, and they always come in pairs, so you see x1 y1 x2 y2 up to xn yn, where xi is an m-dimensional feature vector, and yi for the case of a binary classification training data set, and specifically for training a support vector machine model, is either minus 1 or 1. And of course minus 1 or 1 represents the two different classes of interest. So if you think again of the example by John Dylan Haynes, minus 1 would be cats and plus 1 would be dogs. And the xi are m-dimensional feature vectors, and these m-dimensional feature vectors of course refer to the activation levels in terms of fMRI analysis of m voxels. And we discussed what the different activation levels could be. That could be parameter estimates from a GLM during one run, for example, or single raw data values from a given volume. The M features could be, for example, the M voxels included in a region of interest like V1, or the M voxels included in a searchlight, or the M voxels included in the entire brain if you do whole brain classification. So again, these xi are referred to as feature vectors, and yi are referred to as target variables or labels. This is essentially what I just mentioned. So the class membership is given by yi, and we have the experimental conditions and activation of m voxels. One thing that you of course also can also notice here, we discussed earlier these kind of data matrices in terms of m times n dimensional matrices, and that's the same thing here. So if you concatenate all the feature vectors, you would have an m times n dimensional matrix. And here the important thing is that in addition to this multi-dimensional data matrix, essentially you have a label for each of these feature vectors. And in a way, this kind of distinguishes what we are doing now, where each feature vector has a given label, distinguishes these kind of approaches to be supervised learning approaches in machine learning, because you have a explicit label, whereas the previous approaches that we discuss to some degree were unsupervised. But if you really think about Gaussian models, then of course there were also labels in terms of observed data, and hence it's also not really sensible to call things like factor analysis or PCA unsupervised, because there are also implicit labels. In any case, that's a typical nomenclature in machine learning: supervised for support vector machines and classification approaches, because you have these labels. Now that's the data, Of course, fairly general here, can of course be different things, but if you apply support vector machines, you will always be able to map the data that you use and where you use classification to this kind of idea. If you use binary classification, based on that, we can now give the definition of a linear discriminant function. And the linear discriminant function is crucial in support vector machines. It's of a very similar form as the functions that we will see for logistic regression, and it's also a very similar form to what we will see in neural networks. So we see it here in this form for the first time then for support vector machines. So a linear discriminant function is a multivariate real-valued function. So again, think of the nomenclature. It's taking n, taking in m-dimensional vectors. It is real-valued, and specifically, the values that it takes on are -1 and +1. So the output is just scalar, and it takes such an m-dimensional vector and maps it onto this scalar. I call this linear discriminant function here h, and h is formed by the composition of two functions. First, an affine function f. So affine meaning essentially linear but not going through zero, so it's a, you can also call this linear affine function. Sometimes people also call this linear function, though that's not quite correct, and concatenated with a nonlinear function, and there we will see different forms, and here we kind of use the most basic nonlinear function, which acts like a Heaviside function, if you want, or kind of a step function at zero. So what are these functions? So f is a multivariate real-valued parameter-dependent affine function. So f takes an m-dimensional feature vector, maps it onto a real value, and basically now not only a scalar value but taking on definitely more different values than just -1 and +1, so the r here makes some sense. And x is mapped onto f of x, and this is given by a weight vector or a parameter vector multiplied by the input vector x, and this is of course a dot product, so it gives you a scalar, and then there is a bias, so just a scalar parameter added to that. If the bias is zero, then we actually have a linear function. If the bias parameter here is non-zero, then we have a linear affine function. So this w for the parameter vector as weight is just, of course, some nomenclature. You could also call w beta, then you would be fairly close to what we know from the GLM. You can also call it b, whatever you want to call it. In the context of SVMs, calling it w for weights is just something that is very prominent. Clearly, the values in the weight vector are multiplied with the components of the input vector, so they weight the component vectors, and then everything is added up. And so you have this linear combination of the input vector, and then you add something to it. The important thing, and this will be crucial for what's to come, is that the weights and the bias are free parameters of the linear discriminant function model. So if you basically try to find weight parameters that give you good classification accuracy during training, and you need to estimate these weight parameters. So if you want to emphasize this, you can also put a little subscript here, w on f, so that you always see that the weights go and play a role for how f behaves. So that's the linear affine part of this linear discriminant function, and then there's the nonlinear part. And this is here the univariate real valued parameter independent classification function. So there's this g function doesn't have further parameters and works as follows. It takes a real value, namely f of x, the output of the f function, and maps it onto minus 1 and 1. There's still a typo in the online version. I just corrected this. It gives you the value minus 1 if the value of f of x is smaller than 0, and it gives you the value plus 1 if the value of x is larger or equal to 0. Yeah, so and then by looking at the output of g of f of x, this linear discriminant function makes this distinction or decision of which category it allocates a given input vector to. If it based on x says minus 1, then it means it's in one category. If it says plus 1, then it means it's in the other category. What it precisely assigns, or what it assigns to a given x, of course, depends on the w. If you have a, if you fix the w for the x's that you put in, you will get a certain output pattern in terms of minus ones and plus ones. If you use other weights, what the linear discriminant function returns will, of course, be different. And the question then for SVM training is how to set those weights. If one looks at this from a more geometric perspective, then one can talk about the following, and we will look at a picture in a second. Linear discriminant functions induce three things essentially: a decision boundary, which is referred to as a hyperplane, and this refers to the subset of all x in m-dimensional space for which f of x is 0, because that's where basically the output of the linear discriminant function switches, right? So for exactly 0 it's still plus 1, but if it's just a little bit below 0 then it's minus 1, and if it's if it's exactly 0 or a little bit above 0 then it's plus 1. And then there are two decision regions, so all x in m-dimensional feature space for which the output is smaller than 0 are obviously allocated to one category, and all x's for which the output of f of x is larger than or equal to 0 is obviously allocated to plus 1. Yeah, so these geometric entities in the feature space, they always exist once you have a linear discriminant function. Of course, where they are located in feature space changes. Maybe one thing about the hyperplane. Hyperplanes always have dimensionality of n minus 1, so and that's maybe not completely easy to show, although we will see the line equation and then it makes some sense. So in case of a two-dimensional feature space, the decision boundary or the hyperplane is a line. In case of three-dimensional feature space, the decision boundary is a surface, and so on. And in the case of a one-dimensional feature space, the decision boundary is actually a point, so a zero-dimensional entity. So let's look at a picture, which maybe makes this a little bit clearer. So we are going to stick with the two-dimensional case, so m will always be two-dimensional. Each of our feature vectors will comprise two components, x1 and x2. And in red we have here feature vectors associated with a target variable of minus 1, and in blue we have feature vectors associated with a target variable of plus 1. And here, without talking much of how I get there, I put in a hyperplane, which represents those x's for which f of x equals 0, and then we have two parts here where the f of x is larger than 0. So this would be one of the decision regions, and then here the other decision region. So the question is a little bit how to get to this line in two-dimensional feature space if you are given the weights. So what I'm saying is if you, so a linear discriminant function of course depends on the weights, but the question is how do you how can you plot this line? Yeah, so if you're given some weights you want to and you want to now plot this hyperplane, how do you do it? And this can be done as follows. So you know f of x being 0, that means in terms of the definition of the linear discriminant function, and specifically the f function, that wt times x plus w0 equals 0. And of course you can write this in two or any dimensions, really you can write this in terms of yeah, the actual dot product. So you have w1 times x1 plus w2 times x2 plus w0 equals 0. And then you can of course rewrite this here. You can rewrite the value of x2 as a function of x1. So if you think in terms of yeah, drawing a graph in a Cartesian coordinate system, you can basically now solve the for the value of x2. So what you have here, if you want to call on the y-axis, of course this doesn't really make sense because y are here the target variables and so on, but if you think about the traditional way, like in school, you have the x and the y-axis, so you can evaluate x2 as a function of x1, because there's basically nothing else in there that you don't know. You, the assumption is that you know the weights, and then by solving, yeah, by isolating x2, you need to divide by w2, you need to subtract w1 x1, and you need to subtract w0. So then you see that you get x2 as a function of x1, and what actually happens is that just that you multiply x1 by a scalar and subtract something from it, and this should remind you that this is kind of a yeah, it's also a simple linear regression function if you want, and you know that simple linear regression gives you a line, so you get this line, which also shows as if you have a line that you have a one-dimensional entity in this two-dimensional space. So some people are just waking up, which is also good. So this is the story, or the representation of a linear discriminant function in two-dimensional space. What we haven't really clarified is now how you basically can shift this line around and how the weight parameters determine where the line is situated in two-dimensional space. And that's now the topic for the remainder of this hour. Namely the geometry of these linear discriminant functions. And there are three geometric relationships that I want to show you and that are important in order to understand how the weights that you learn, for example, for a linear discriminant function in the context of SVM, how the weights determine the geometric property, meaning the orientation and the location of these decision boundaries. So to formalize this, let F be the multivariate revariate parameter dependent affine function that goes into the linear discriminant function, as we've just seen. So again, for an m-dimensional feature vector x, f returns the dot product of x with a weight vector w and adds to it the scalar bias. And as we also have seen already, is that there's an associated hyperplane, which is the set of all axes for which fx equals 0. And we've seen that for 2D, this is a line. And we can extrapolate from that that for 3D, this would be a surface and so on. But of course, this would need some general proof. In any case, we say that we call this set of the x, whether whatever the dimensionality of the subspace is, we call this the associated hyperplane. Just as a reminder, by these two bars with the 2 here for a vector, we mean the dot product of the vector and the square root of that, which is also called the Euclidean length of the vector. So if you have a vector in 2D, the length of that is given by this. Now this is the situation, and then the following geometric relationships hold. First of all, the weight vector is orthogonal to any vector pointing in the direction of the hyperplane. Yeah? So any weight vector is in a specific relationship to the direction of the hyperplane, namely it is orthogonal. I will show you what this means in a picture in a second. The minimal Euclidean distance d between a feature vector and a point on the hyperplane is given by 1 divided by the Euclidean norm of the weight vector times fx. And this is important because it tells you something about the meaning of the output of the function f. Namely, if it's large, then the minimal Euclidean distance between this x and the hyperplane is also large. In terms of its absolute value, and in terms of its sign, it also means that it depends on where it is located, so either to the one side of the hyperplane or the other side. Again, the picture will follow. And finally, the minimal Euclidean distance d0 between the origin and a point on the hyperplane is given by the bias divided by the Euclidean length of the weight parameter. And this is important because this determines where the hyperplane is located in 2D, so or in the feature space with respect to the origin. So if you want, so this orthogonality is about the orientation of the hyperplane, as we will see, and this minimal Euclidean distance with respect to the orientation is about the location of the hyperplane in space. So here's the picture. So first of all, the orthogonality of the weight vector and the hyperplane, which just means there's a right angle between the weight vector, which of course has the same dimensionality as the feature vector, because you can form their dot product. And the important thing of this is that they are orthogonal. And if you now basically take my index finger, maybe now look at the video, my index finger being the hyperplane and my thumb being the weight vector, then the point is that they will always be orthogonal. So if you now turn on the thumb, the whole thing shifts. Yeah. So what doesn't happen is that you kind of push them together or something. They are always orthogonal and stay fixed like that. So you kind of have a handle, which is now the thumb, that you can use to turn the index finger. It's awesome. It's like a human robot. See that? Can go almost like this, but it can't go further. But for the hyperplane, you can go further. So that's the point here. So the orthogonality of the weight vector and the hyperplane allows you, by changing the weight vector, which is something that you do during parameter learning, to change the orientation of the hyperplane. The second thing is that the bias parameter determines the distance from the origin. So again, if you now think of the my index finger here as the hyperplane, and you consider the left lower corner of the video the origin, then the bias parameter cannot change the orientation of this. This is only what the thumb can do. this is the thumb. Sorry. And but the bias parameter can change the distance from the origin. So it can move, by changing the bias parameter, you can move the hyperplane closer to the origin, further away, or to the other side. Now it's on the other side. Now you don't see it. Now it's back again. Now it's in another quadrant. And now the picture is just over, so you can't see it anymore. Anyway, that's what the weight the bias parameter can do. I shouldn't fool around. I should concentrate. So that's the important notions of the weight vector and the bias parameter in terms of the geometry of the hyperplane, so how it is oriented and where it is located, and finally the relationship between the output of the linear discriminant function and the distance of a feature vector in with respect to the hyperplane is shown here. So here we have a feature vector, here we have its orthogonal projection to the hyperplane. So we actually talked about projections before, so you might have a little bit of an idea what this is. And this is also the shortest distance from here to here. So if you would not go orthogonally to that, then you would need a longer way, which is relatively intuitive. Now the point here is that this distance is actually given by the output of the linear discriminant function divided by the Euclidean length of the vector. And these properties, from my perspective, they are a little bit surprising. So I mean, we have so far we have this definition, and now I'm telling you all about these geometric properties, which are useful because they allow us to change the weight vector and hence change the location of the hyperplane in space, and also give us some interpretation for the output of the linear function in terms of the relationship of a given feature vector to the hyperplane. But they are not immediately clear, at least not to me. So hence I included proofs here to show why that holds. And let me briefly check what else we need to do in this hour. Oh well, I think I will go over the proofs, and maybe we then do the other things in the next hour. That's all fine. So let's go over the proofs. So let's ask why this actually is the case. And we are going to first look at the proof for why the weight vector is orthogonal to any vector pointing in the direction of H. And then we look at this, and then we're going to talk about the origin. So first, the proof of why the weight vector is orthogonal to any vector pointing in the direction of the hyperplane. And to this end, let's consider two points on the hyperplane. By definition of the hyperplane, it then follows that wt times xa plus w0 is 0, because xa is on the hyperplane, and hyperplane means that the x is such that the output of the f function is 0, and this is just what's written here. Xb is also supposed to be on the hyperplane, so also wt times xb plus w0 equals 0. So for example, xa could be a point here and xb could be a point here. If we subtract this equation from this equation, just because we can, then of course the bias goes away, and we can basically bracket out the wt and have xa minus xb being 0. Now xa, in terms of a visualization, xa minus xb is a vector that points actually in the direction from xa to xb, or xb to xa. In any case, it's completely in line with the hyperplane, if you think of your basic vector calculus that you hopefully did in school. And we see hence that Wt times this vector which points in the direction of the hyperplane is zero. The weight vector is hence, so because orthogonality is defined as the fact that the scalar product of two, or the dot product of two vectors, is zero, the weight vector is hence orthogonal to the vector yxa minus xb, which, as I just said, points into the direction of the hyperplane. Yeah, and because we chose these xa and xb completely arbitrarily, we basically now have shown the results. It wouldn't really work if xa equals xb, but that's also not interesting. Yeah, so this is how one can show the case that or the point that the weight vector is orthogonal to the hyperplane. Again, the important practical implication is that if you now change the weight vector, you also turn around. So if you turn around the weight vector, you also turn around the hyperplane, so you have a handle on the orientation of the hyperplane. Second thing to show is that the minimal Euclidean distance between a point x, so a feature vector, and a point on the hyperplane is given by 1 divided by the weight vector's Euclidean length times the output of the linear affine function. So how can one show that? To this end, we first consider the decomposition of a point x into its orthogonal projection onto a hyperplane, which we call xp, and its distance from the hyperplane, which is d times the normalized weight vector. So where does this come from? And this is the decomposition. So x is given by xp plus it's the distance of x from the hyperplane, and xp is on the hyperplane. So that's what's also shown on this graph. So this is our x. This is the orthogonal projection of x onto xp. So the idea is that we have a the hyperplane is fixed, and we now have a 90 degree angle here. So we go in this direction, and the distance from this distance here, so this gray value, is obviously, because the weight vector is orthogonal, is obviously in this direction. And you know that if you divide a vector by its Euclidean length, then the length of this is 1. So the length of this vector here is d, whatever d may be, times 1. This dw divided by the Euclidean length of w refers to this vector and its length. Yeah. So it's in this direction of the weight vector, because this is orthogonal, and it's of length d times 1. It is of length d times w divided by the Euclidean length of w. Now, this is the decomposition of this point, and decomposition just because if you want to go to x, you go from xp to you start from xp and then you go into this direction to x. Actually, I should at the beginning of the next course give you a link to some cool YouTube videos on these relationships of vectors and lists that you often find in linear algebra. In any case, if you use this, then so this is just what I explained a couple of times now, that this is possible because w is orthogonal to any point vector point in the direction of a hyperplane, and the length of this is 1. Now we have this decomposition, so we look at the output of the linear affine function and put into this put this decomposition in. So we have wtx plus w0, and then for x we take this decomposition, which is always possible, and we get wt times xp plus dw divided by the Euclidean length of w plus w. And then we just resolve the brackets, so we get wt times xp plus w0 plus d times wt times w. And then the point is that xp is on the hyperplane. That means the output of the linear affine function for xp is zero. So this first part here, wt xp plus w0, goes away. And the only thing that remains is d times wt w divided by the Euclidean length. And this is obviously the square of the Euclidean length, because the Euclidean length is just the square root of this, so it's the square, so we can get rid of 1. So we see that f of x equals the distance, so the scalar distance of x from the hyperplane times the Euclidean length of the weight vector. And then we can just solve this for d, and we see that d corresponds to 1 over the Euclidean length of the weight vector times fx. So we have shown the second part here, and obviously, and this is also why it comes second, we need this orthogonality to show this. And then the third thing, namely that the minimal Euclidean distance between the origin and a point on h is w0 divided by w square. This needs this property, so this is why it comes up third. So for the minimal distance of the origin, and the origin is obviously the vector 0, 0, 0, to points on the hyperplane, so we're now using this distance that we discovered, or that we just proved in the second step. This distance for x0 is given by 1 over the Euclidean length of w times f of x0, because we are now considering the point of x0. Now then we put in x0, and what we if we resolve the brackets here, we get 1 over the Euclidean length of the weight vector times the zero vector, and this thing times w0. And clearly this dot product here, because these are all zeros, is 0, so we are left with a w0 divided by the Euclidean length of the weight vector. So we also have shown this part. Yeah. So this is how one can show these things, and then I think yeah, you can say you don't like math and this is why you still don't find it intuitive. I'm then happy with to see how these relations come about. Good. What's up next? Yeah, I would say just we have a break here, because we've now introduced the basic geometry of this whole business, and the main points to take from this is that with the weight vector and the bias parameter, we have a way of modifying the decision boundary or the hyperplane in space. Yeah, again, by changing the weight vector, we change its orientation. By changing the bias parameter, we change where it is located. So we have a means to actually carry out these kind of transformations. Yeah, so we now know if we have if you have, for example, a two-dimensional case, and we want to move around our hyperplane, we know that we have to modify the weight vector or the bias parameter to achieve a certain setting of that. The next thing is then for support vector machines, we want to achieve a specific setting, and we get to more specific interpretations and of certain things. So we will introduce the notion of a margin, for example, and this is what we are going to do in the next hour. So are there any questions right now for these basic geometric properties that we've seen now? That doesn't seem to be the case. So let's have a break and start again at 9:30. Okay, then let's continue. And before I continue with the details of support vector machine nomenclature, then with respect to this linear discriminant function, I want to point you to these very nice videos by a Google account called 3Blue1Brown. I'm actually not, I don't know who's behind that. I mean, it shouldn't be too hard to find out, but it's actually a very nice Google account. It has teaching videos which are actually really nice, so they don't do the most basic thing that you can just read in a book, and it's very very quick, but they discuss, for example, with respect to linear algebra, very nicely this relationship and these two views of vectors in terms of lists, in terms of very nice about approach to presenting this.
Now, while I'm sure that many of you are already familiar with this coordinate system, it's worth walking through explicitly, since
I think you don't hear it, but I hear it, so it's a little bit irritating. So, if you want to learn more about these basic geometric properties of vectors and how they work, really have a series, have a look at this series. It has a lot of things. There are also other series, so it's really, really good. Yeah, have a look at it if you are not completely familiar. But also for me, it's of course I've looked at these things before, but they have a nice twist on things, and it's really really nice. Good, but let's continue with our main topic then. So we have now introduced the basic geometry. So we have introduced how weight vectors can determine linear discriminant functions geometrically. Now we're going to expand on this by introducing more nomenclature and concepts related specifically to support vector machines, which of course rest on these linear discriminant functions. So first two things to introduce now are the notion of a hyperplane margin, because we already said that the support vector machine wants to do maximum margin classification, so we need to define what the margin actually is, and then also to introduce the notion of a support vector, because they're called support vector machines, so it makes sense to at least define why they're called support vector machines. The machine term in this is just fanciness, so it's not a machine, it's an algorithm or a model or whatever. It's just, it's cooler to call it machine than to call it support vector model algorithm or whatever. In any case, so what are hyperplanes margins and what are support vectors? To this end, we focus again on a training set. So support vectors and hyperplane margins are always defined with respect to a given training set. We consider our function f, which is still multivariate real valued affine function, and the hyperplane that is induced by f. Then for each feature vector in the training data set, we now define the absolute value of the minimal Euclidean distance of the training feature vector from the hyperplane. And the absolute value of, and we call this di. So the absolute value here is, the absolute value of the minimal Euclidean distance of the training feature value is obviously the absolute value of di, which we found to be, so actually this is more equal sign than a definition here, which we found to be 1 over the weight vector's Euclidean length times the output of the function f for the input vector xi. This is what we did in the previous hour. Now this, to get to the absolute value here, you need to remember that the output of the function f is negative if the class associated with that is minus one, and it's positive if the class associated with that is plus one. So this absolute value here, so these two bars, can be implemented also by multiplication with the target variable. Yeah. So if f of xi is negative, if you multiply it by the corresponding target label, which is minus one, then you get something positive. And if the output of f is positive, then yi is also positive, and you again get the positive value. Yeah. So this is where this yi comes in. It's for the absolute value. And then the this we can just so the function f we can obviously just write out as wt times xi plus w0. Yeah, and this absolute value, because it's an absolute value, it's always larger or equal to zero, because it's an absolute value, and absolute values turn negative numbers into positive, or absolute, the absolute operation turns negative values into positive numbers. So that's the minimal Euclidean distance of the training feature vector xi from the hyperplane. Now the margin, which we denote by d star of h, with respect to the hyperplane, with respect to the data set, so it's always with respect to the data set, is defined as the minimum of the absolute minimal Euclidean distances of the training feature vectors to the hyperplane. So the margin is the smallest of all these absolute distances of the feature vector from the hyperplane. So which is just written out here, d star is the minimum of these absolute values of the feature vector distances over all I, so over all feature vectors in the training set. And then again we can rewrite this as this, as we've done here. So it's just the minimum over all of these. And a training set feature vector xi is referred to as a support vector if its absolute distance from the hyperplane equals the margin, or if it's located on the margin. And so here's a visualization. So we have a training set comprising six feature vectors. We have a hyperplane that we just put in here, and the question now is what is the margin of this hyperplane? So if the hyperplane is located here with respect to this training set, what is the margin? And to evaluate the margin, we need to evaluate the distance, the absolute distance. So maybe we should put a absolute sign here. That's a typo. So we need to evaluate the distance, the absolute distance of each feature vector from the hyperplane. So for feature vector 1, this is the distance. For feature vector 2, this is the distance. For feature vector 3, this is the distance, and so on. And then we find need to find the minimum absolute value. The minimum here with two bars here. And of course you can because these distances are obviously negative, so in terms of their non-absolute value, of course this is the smallest distance here because it's a negative distance, but in terms of the absolute value, where this negative sign here goes away, of course the one that you see geometrically or physically as smallest is this one. This means that this by definition then is the margin of the hyperplane, because that's the smallest absolute distance to any of the feature vectors. Yeah? So the margin is then this, and the margin goes both ways if you want. So it has the margin goes in this direction but also in this direction, because it's this absolute thing or whatever. Because it could be either here or there. So the margin here is the dashed line, and by definition x2 is then a support vector for this hyperplane, because it's located on the margin, or because its absolute distance corresponds to from the hyperplane corresponds to the distance. Yeah, so that's an important definition. And how this comes into play in terms of training, we will then see, but we first need these definitions. We also need now attend to the thing that actually the hyperplanes, or let's say the weights that are associated with hyperplanes, are not unique, and so we need to decide for a weight vector that is unique if we want to kind of identify some weight vector as our favorite weight vector for example, maximum margin or soft margin classification. So first, this thing that the mapping from hyperplanes to weight vectors is not unique comes with this definition of equivalent hyperplanes. So again, let f denote our multivariate real-valued function, and let h be the set of all x for which f of x is zero, be a hyperplane. Then all scalar multiples of f, which means all scalar multiples of w and w0. So if you think about multiplying a times fx, that means if you substitute in what f means, that you multiply w and w0 by the scalar a, induce the identical hyperplane. Because if the output of fx is 0, it follows that a f of x is 0 for all a that for all scalars that are non-zero. Of course, for a equals 0, it also follows, but we are interested in the case when a is not 0. All sets x all hyperplanes, so all sets subsets of the m-dimensional feature vectors for which a times f of x equals zero for any non-zero a are referred to as equivalent hyperplanes to H, and they are the same sets, but they come with a different weight parameterizations. But now, if we have a support vector and a set of W and W0s inducing the equivalent hyperplanes, the canonical hyperplane is defined as that hyperplane, and here it's important that it's the specific W and W0. So because the problem is here that the hyperplane is in looking at it is always the same, but it can be parameterized with different values for W and W0, and we chose, or support vector machines better, chose those W and W0 for which the absolute value of the output of the linear affine function for a support vector, which is here marked with a star, so its associated target variable is y star, and the feature vector itself is x star, equals 1. Yeah? So essentially, we scale, and that's the main point, we scale the weight vector and the bias such that the distance of a support vector to the hyperplane is 1. Yeah? So the way you can see it is that for a given hyperplane, you can scale the weight vector in different ways, because in terms of and also the bias, because the weight vector is just orthogonal to the hyperplane, and whether it's very long or so whether the thumb is very long or very small doesn't matter. The important thing is that's orthogonal. So also a very long thumb, a very long weight vector, is orthogonal to the hyperplane, and as the distance from the origin, so the relationship with W0 is always norm, includes this normalization of the weight, also W0 is affected by this. In any case, to decide how long this thumb weight vector is, you say, okay, we want to make it of that length that yields a distance for a support vector to the hyperplane by one. Yeah, it's just essentially it's a kind of a identifiability question. So you have many parameters that give you a hyperplane of that has a certain geometric setting. And the question is, which weights do you now choose? And here the choice is just to take this. Could have done it differently, but that's how they did it. But this then implies that that the margin of the canonical hyperplane, which is given by the distance of a support vector, or the minimum distance, which is then the minimal distance of a feature vector to the hyperplane, this feature vector is then called a support vector. This distance is then 1 over the Euclidean length of the weight vector, because the output for this support vector is 1. Yeah, and this then follows that the margin of the canonical hyperplane is given by 1 over the Euclidean length of the weight vector. Yeah, so this then yields a fairly simple definition and parameterization of the margin. It's just 1 over the Euclidean length of the weight vector. And if you now want a large margin, you want to make this large. If you want a small margin, which you don't want, but if you wanted it, you make this small. Yeah. So this is both of these. So these things that I introduce here, they are crucial to understand why the training problem of training a support vector machine looks like it does. Yeah. So it actually, it motivates or gives the key definitions for understanding the formulation of the training problem of a support vector machine. Any questions regarding this? Good. Now we have introduced a lot of geometric properties, and we also introduced the notion of a hyperplane margin and of support vectors, so linear discriminant functions, and that you change the weights and that they then have different orientations in your feature space. That's a general property for all linear discriminant functions. Of course, the definition of a margin and of a support vector, specifically a support vector, are of course closely entangled with the notion of support vector machines. And now we come to the question that we are mainly interested in answering, namely the question of how, given a training set, how do you find the decision boundary that you then can use for predicting the class membership of your test data. So again, let's briefly jump back to John's figures. So we are all focusing on this part here. So we have some training data, and we are now learning the question is now how to learn this decision rule, and the decision rule, as we've already seen for a support vector machine, corresponds to learning the weights of this linear discriminant function. And we are now basically looking at this part. In terms of practical applications of this, this is essentially what the toolbox gives you. And once the toolbox gave it to you, you can do what you're really interested in, namely cross-validation and prediction and accuracy maps and stuff like that. And then do some weird statistical tests, for example, the t-test on it, because you don't know what else you should do. Anyway, this we've now established basically all the conceptual foundations for this training, and now we're actually looking at the training process itself. And in contrast to what you're used to when I talk, namely that I will say, then we use maximum likelihood, or we do Bayesian inference, I will not say that today, because we haven't really talked about any distributions of anything. So in support vector machines, there are no distributions of anything. There are just these geometric properties that we talked about. And now we formalize that we want, for example, a maximum margin hyperplane. We formalize that in terms of these geometric definitions that we have seen. And to do that, we first need two other definitions, namely the notions of a linear separable and a non-linear separable training set, which are not, so they are, intuitively they are really simple. I think formally they are not that simple, but we will also not really treat them formally. So a training set D is called linearly separable, is called a linearly separable training set if a linear discriminant function exists such that all training points can be classified correctly. On the other hand, a training set D is called a non-linearly separable training set if no linear discriminant function exists such that all training data points can be classified correctly. So it's kind of a mathematical existence definition. And then to show that for a given training set, to show that for a given training set might even be that it exists, might even be easier than to prove that none such exists. I don't know, depends on how you do it. I haven't thought much along the ways of how one can actually, for a given training set, prove that it exists. I mean, if you find one, then you know that it exists. But if you have a hard time finding one, how can you be really sure that you just didn't find it? So I haven't really done any mathematics on that. But of course, intuitively, it's really simple, because if you look at a training set like this, you know, if I put a straight line in there, then I can do well in terms of the classification in the training set. Although actually I would, in this case, this decision boundary, I would move a little bit towards the lower right, so to also get this point and this point correctly classified in the training set. In this case, if you think you're just are allowed to put a line through that, it's really not clear how you can do that. If you know a little bit about the history of artificial intelligence, and you know what an exclusive OR problem is, then you might know that the first winter of AI happened after it was shown that the perceptron cannot solve the XOR problem, because for this you also have a non-separable training set problem. And this is then what kept artificial intelligence research on the backbone for some time. But we are dealing just with this basic visual intuition here. So a linear separable training set is, you look at it and you can see, okay, I can put a line through it, so it's a linear separable. We will actually also talk about how to train for non-linear separable or not linearly separable training data set. Now, if the training data set is in fact linear separable, so you can find a decision boundary that you can position in such a way that all the feature vectors of one category are on one side and all the other from the other category are on the other side, so you can get complete training data or training set prediction accuracy, then maximum margin classification is a way to go and makes sense, which of course means that you want to maximize the margin. And how can this be formalized? Well, we start with a linearly separable training set. And the support vector machine training for maximum margin classification problem corresponds to the constraint optimization problem of minimizing the square of the Euclidean length of the weight vector subject to the constraints that yi times the output of the linear discriminant function for the feature vector xi is larger or equal to 1 for all i going from 1 to n, so for all feature vectors. The question is now why. So that maybe in some way, some sense, comes a little bit surprising, but it makes sense if you relate it back to the definitions of margins and support vectors and so on, and equivalent and canonical hyperplanes, as I showed you previously. Specifically, the objective of minimizing this entity, where the square just comes in for mathematical convenience, specifically if you compute derivatives, the same for 1/2, that this goes away. Minimizing the essentially, so what this says, minimizing the Euclidean length of the weight vector is of course the same as maximizing 1 over the Euclidean length. Yeah, so if you divide by that, so if you make this very small, then 1 over this gets large. Now 1 over this is obviously the hyperplane margin, so this is what we for the canonical hyperplane. Yeah, so the margin is this, so minimizing the Euclidean length corresponds to maximizing the margin. Yeah, and that's something that we want to do in maximum margin classification. So we want to find the hyperplane that has the widest margin. And these constraints correspond to the aim of all feature vectors to either be support vectors, so for which the because this is the distance from the hyperplane is either 1, or then they are feature vectors, or they are supposed to be on the correct side of the hyperplane, so the absolute value here should be larger or equal to 1, irrespective of which side of the hyperplane they are on. Yeah. So this is what is shown here. So you want to orientate your hyperplane in such a way that the margin gets maximal. So this would be for this orientation and location of the hyperplane, the margin would and the support vector would be given by this red thing here. So you want to maximize the margin, and you want to have accurate prediction for the entire training set. Again, this refers to the problem. If you don't see quite what the problem is, because you always see this line, and this line is actually at the right position, this refers to this problem. Yeah. So why not, for example, take this horizontal line, or why not take this diagonal line? Why take, and this is actually the maximum margin case here, why take this hyperplane? Or decision boundary, hence weight vector and bias vector. Well, because it maximizes the margin. And then the question is, why do you want to maximize the margin? Intuitively, it makes sense. Yeah, then you have good separation. If you want to talk more about why maximizing the margin is a good thing, then you of course need to start talking about the distribution of the distribution of the feature vectors and the aim of cross-validation and good prediction. And this is not something that we will do there, or that we will do now. Yeah. So this optimality question of why a large margin is a good thing, that's something you can read about in statistical learning theory, and maybe at one point in my life I will teach that. Right now I'm more concerned with the fact of explaining how training for a maximum margin actually works, how the weights need to be set if you want to train a support vector machine. So let's go back to where we were. Actually, I want to go by one slide. Yeah. Yeah. So that's the aim of doing maximum margin classification, but of course this only really is applicable if you can actually find a decision boundary that separates the feature vectors of your two categories well. So for example, if you have, if this blue dot would be down here, then I would have a hard time imagine how a straight line in feature space now would get the blue dot here on the, so for example, if the blue dot is exactly here, how this blue dot can also be on the blue category part of this feature space. This with a straight line, that's I think impossible. And currently we're only considering straight lines, obviously. However, in this case of not necessarily linearly separable training set, there is the concept of soft margin classification. And maximum margin classification that was invented by Wapnick in 1964, 30 years later, they invented soft margin classification, which allows for some misclassification, essentially. And soft margin classification is what most people use in fMRI data analysis. So you don't aim for complete accuracy on the, so for 100% accuracy on the training data, but you allow that some of the training data patterns are actually misclassified. But you try to still to find a somewhat of a good large margin classification bound. And this looks as follows. Let the data set be not necessarily linearly separable. Then what is called soft margin classification corresponds to the constraint optimization problem of, again, minimizing the Euclidean length of the weight vector, which corresponds to maximizing the margin, plus minimizing this term where you have some variables C, which are called slack variables, which I will explain in a second. You take these slack variables C, I, so there exists one slack variable for each feature vector and each target variable. You take them to some form of power, for example, to the power of 1, when you call, then you call this kind of term the hinge loss term, or to the power of 2, then you call the quadratic loss term. You take them to the power, sum them all up, and you try to minimize this term. This term is called also a loss term, so you try to minimize the loss, and you multiply the loss with a factor C, which determines how much you emphasize in this entire minimization problem. You emphasize this loss term over the weight term, and this is the C parameter is typically chosen empirically, so this is always something that you can look at in terms of fMRI paper. If they're doing SVM classification and they don't report what value for C they chose, because that's something you actually need to put in the toolbox, then you might want to ask them what value of C they used. Usually then they use the default of 1. So you try to minimize this, and again you have these constraints, namely that this value here, so yi times the output of the linear discriminant function is larger or equal to 1, now minus xi, and the entire xi vectors or all xi are supposed to be larger than zero. So why is this now interesting? What's the idea? It aims to maximize the hyperplane margin, like previously in maximum margin classification, while minimizing the loss. So this is the loss. So that's what this part does. The question is, what do these slack variables mean, and what's the point there? So there you need to think about what this means if xi is always larger than zero. Then of course you can have three cases, namely if xi equal or larger than zero. If this is zero, then you would be, if xi is zero, then you would be again in the case of complete correct classification on the training data set, because you would be in this case. Yeah. If xi is between 0 and 1, then you still have correct training exemplar classification, because the feature vector is on the correct side of the hyperplane, but it's within the margin, but it's still correct. And so you allow for the soft margin, so the margin is not so not all training feature vectors are really beyond the margin, but they might be in the space between the hyperplane and the margin. So that's for xi being small, so being zero between 0 and 1. And if xi for a given yeah, I think actually this should be xi, that would be better, because xi is the entire vector. So here we want xi actually. Let's put a note, although if I don't get reminded of this, I might actually forget it again. Where's the commenter? So this needs to be xi. And the same thing here. Some of the comment function only shows up occasionally. Now it showed up. Also needs to be xi. If xi is larger than 1, then you obviously get a negative thing here. So then you get a misclassified exemplar. So the only thing that I'm showing actually here is the case that for this red one, the xi is or xi1 is larger than 1. So the distance of this red one to the hyperplane is is negative, so it's on the so it's on the wrong side of the hyperplane, and the same thing for blue, for this blue dot. What I don't show here, which one should maybe put in there, is the case that for example this red dot is here, so it's on the right side of the hyperplane, but it's within the or between the margin and the hyperplane. Yeah, so in this case you try to position the hyperplane, you try to find weights that position the hyperplane in such a way that most of the time you get correct classification, and but you allow for some slack if you want, so you allow for the fact that not all feature vectors are really outside of the margin, and you allow for the case that not even all feature vectors are correctly classified, but you try to minimize the case that this happens. Yeah? So that's the idea of soft margin classification. Now, so these are the basic training problems. So in a way you could, the way you can understand them in analogy to what you are hopefully used to by now, so in analogy to maximum likelihood, in maximum likelihood you say the parameters that we're interested in maximize the likelihood function. Here there is no likelihood function because there are no, that's not a probabilistic model, but there's also an objective function like the likelihood function, and you say the parameters that I like, they fulfill these criteria, namely the maximize the margin, minimize misclassification, and feature vectors being too close to the margin. This is the objective function for soft margin classification, and again for maximum margin classification you say I want to maximize the margin, and everything should be classified correctly. So these are your objective functions, and like in maximum likelihood function, you then basically need to shift around your parameters to achieve this maximum. And you've seen how we do it in maximum likelihood estimation. We either can do it analytically, so we find a maximum of the log likelihood function and then we are happy with our maximum likelihood estimator, or we use some nonlinear numerical programming technique to shift around the parameters and find a maximum, and then we use the output of such a numerical maximum likelihood approach. And again, the problem or the aim is defined in terms of maximizing the log likelihood function with respect to the parameters, and this is what we've formulated here. So the aim of which is so maybe to get this really clear, in maximum likelihood estimation the intuitive aim is that we look for the parameters such that the probability of the data under the models and these parameters is maximal. Here the intuition is that we maximize the margin and get correct classification on the training set, or we maximize the margin and allow for some slack. That's the intuition. Technically, this then refers to the problem of maximizing the likelihood function, or in this case with respect to the parameters, or in this case minimizing these objective functions under these constraints. The last thing that you then need to do once you formulate the problem is of course to solve this problem. Again, you can do that analytically in maximum likelihood sometimes, but you often also do it numerically. The same thing goes for SVM training. And the SVM story then in terms of now solving these technical formulations or these mathematical formulations of the intuition of maximizing the margin goes into the domain of constrained nonlinear programming, specifically the part of nonlinear programming that deals with quadratic programs or problems. And this will actually be the topic of the last hour. Essentially, the topic of the last hour, if you look at the study questions, it will not feature in the study questions. It's also mainly of technical interest, however not quite. So one thing that looking at the dual problem of maximum margin SVM training, which corresponds to a quadratic program, gave rise to the whole field of kernel methods. And this is why, if you want to understand kernel methods and how they come about and why they're interesting, you cannot really ignore the dual problem of maximum margin SVM training or the dual problem of soft margin SVM training, although it's more or less a technical issue. What the dual problem allows to do is to formulate SVM training as a quadratic programming problem, to which you can then apply standard quadratic programming solvers. And That's one thing. That's the technical side of things. The other thing is that it motivates kernel methods. And in the last hour, then I want to, first basically, give you this kernel idea, and then give you a rough overview of where this actually coming from and how it relates to constraints optimization. Again, the last hour will be purely technical and will be we will not go over the equations one by one, so I will just give you an overview about this technical aspects. They are mainly interested in, if you are interested in kernel methods, then you should really make an effort to understand this. And they are also interesting if you really want to train an SVM yourself rather than using a toolbox for training SVM. And yourself meaning that you use still a toolbox, but you use a quadratic programming solver, or you implement your own quadratic programming solver rather than just putting your feature vectors and labels into SVM lib or something like that. Okay, let's have a final break before we go into this. Are there any questions right now? That doesn't seem to be the case. So let's have a break and continue at 10:30. Okay, so then in the last hour I will talk about some advanced, not exam relevant stuff with respect to support vector machines, which, however, if you look into the theory of support vector machines, features there quite prominently and often doesn't get quite clear, or at least that's where I had the hardest time of understanding what's going on with SVMs. And this refers to the fact of reformulating the SVM training problems which we have now seen as quadratic programs. And the main theorem in this regard for maximum margining SVM training is on this slide and the next. There is a equivalent theorem for soft margin SVM training, which I think I removed now from the lecture because I didn't provide a proof, so I thought, why bring it up if I don't prove it? But of course it exists and it can also be proven. However, that's not in these lecture slides, so that's why it's not there at this point. So the thing with this reformulation of SVM training as a quadratic programming problem is that it taps quite deep into constraint optimization. So one can only really appreciate this whole business if one is somewhat familiar with constraint optimization. And this of course relates back to the thing that I said in the very beginning of the machine learning course, that a lot of these things in the end lead to optimization or constraint optimization problems, and this is fairly evident and fairly strongly the case for support vector machines. So I can basically not tell you this theorem, and then you will see, if you're not familiar with constraint optimization, that there are certain terms that you will not know about. Namely, the first thing is the dual problem. The dual problem is a term from constraint optimization. I will briefly show you in a second what that is. Essentially, it's kind of an equivalent problem. So instead of solving this maximum margining SVM training problem, so finding weights that minimize the Euclidean length subject to these inequality constraints, instead of solving this, you solve another problem which yields the same results. That's basically the idea. The dual problem is given by this, so you maximize some function q of some parameters lambda, and this function q comprises the sum of these lambda values, and it comprises this double sum of these various lambda values, the products of always two feature of two target variables, and this is the main intuitive point here, or not even intuitive, but the main point, the dot product of a feature vector pair. So you have here xi times xj, which is a dot product. And this is this function q, which you try to maximize, and you also do this maximization under some constraint, namely that this lambda is larger or equal to zero, so all the components are larger or equal to zero, and that the sum of the lambda I times the yi equals zero. Then you get a solution lambda, but what you actually wanted is a weight parameter, right? So there are then formulas how you can use the lambda parameter together with the target variable, the optimal lambda parameter, sorry, so given a solution of the dual problem, lambda bar, you can turn this lambda bar into an optimal weight parameter and an optimal bias parameter, and this you do using these two formulas. Of course, the question is all the time, why does this work? So I'm just telling you basically the result, and that it works is implied. Now, this is relatively close to actually a quadratic program problem. To really put it into quadratic program form, which are problems of minimizing something like this. Though I wonder whether... No, I think I'm fine. I'm just wondering whether I have a minus sign problem here, but I... don't think so. You need to further simplify this expression by defining some matrices, and one matrix you define here is, for example, the matrix of all dot products of the feature vectors, and then you multiply this by the outer product of the target variables, and then you get this P matrix in a quadratic program. Of course, if you don't know what a quadratic program is, formulating it like this also doesn't help you, and again, quadratic programs are part of constraint nonlinear optimization. The one thing that why I'm presenting it like this right now is that these dot products of all feature vectors feature quite prominently here, and you try to you do something with that, and this means in a way that if you are computing these optimal lambda value, and hence which you can turn into the optimal weights and biases, you don't need to deal with the feature vectors themselves. Yeah, so you never need to somehow have a 100-dimensional vector that you need to somehow multiply with something and so on. What you always need are these mutual dot products. Yeah, and dot products are of course always one-dimensional. So if you have your training data and you form all the dot products between all your feature vectors, then you have you can basically fill in this what is also called kernel matrix here, and then you can do the optimization, yeah, without then doing optimization again having to deal with high dimensional feature vectors. And this is of course computationally efficient, and also has then inspired the people working on SVMs to think about more, okay, if it's just the dot products of the feature vectors that play a role, what does that actually mean? And dot products are, of course, or this form, these form of dot products are a special case of what we've already seen as a more general thing that determine things in Euclidean vector spaces, and that are some measures of similarity. And this motivated machine learning researchers to think about, okay, if I not only look at dot products in this Euclidean space, but maybe, I look at dot products in Euclidean spaces always, but I look at dot products maybe after some nonlinear transformation, what does happen? And this is then what motivated kernel methods. So the idea is that you have feature vectors which are high dimensional, but maybe in the space that you're looking at, they are such that you can't linearly separate your training set. Then the hope is that if you map them into an even higher higher dimensional feature space by projecting each training vector by some nonlinear function, or maybe even linear function, but in any case you make the dimensionality of the training vectors even larger, that they then somehow populate this higher dimensional feature space in a way that they are linearly separable, and you can do maximum margin classification in there. That's of course only a hope. I think I'm not sure that maybe there is some I would assume maybe there's some theorem that says if you make the dimensionality high enough, maybe that's actually the case, if you make the dimensionality high enough, then any nonlinear separable training set can be at one point be linearly separable. Maybe there's a theorem like that. I would have a hunch that this exists, but I don't know. But per se, and of course because you're in a practical scenario, you need to define what kind of transformation you do, you can more or less hope for that this works. But this is then the idea of kernel methods, because the scalar products that you then form, because here you don't do the mapping but you have a scalar product, but in the higher dimensional feature space you do the scalar product, these are referred to as kernels. And the good thing is that this increasing dimensionality of your feature space doesn't matter, because computational, because you're interested in the scalar product, hence a zero-one dimensional value, a scalar in the end after all. This then always comes with these kind of pictures. So here you have, and this is a case where this actually works, here you have a two-dimensional problem where you have kind of a circle form of vectors that form the one category, and around you have the other category. So here you cannot find a hyperplane, a line that separates this. If you use a sensible map, which in this case has to do, which I actually don't show here, but which has to do with forming polar versus Cartesian coordinates and increasing the dimensionality, you can map these all these points into a three-dimensional vector space. So here you see z1, z2, z3. Here you only have x1 and x2, and based on this mapping, the distribution in this three-dimensional feature space then looks like this, which you can actually separate using a hyperplane. Yeah, of course this is kind of a didactic example where this works. On the other hand, you can say, okay, if my training patterns for some reason actually have this kind of roughly this kind of behavior, then I always know that I can still use maximum margin classification in some higher dimensional feature space. And this then is this whole business of kernel methods for which Bernhard Schulkopf and Alexander Smola worked for some time. Don't know how much Bernhard Schulkopf is still doing with this kernel business, because he seems to be more into causality lately, but yeah, the 2000s were basically the time of kernel, so 2000 to 2010, time of kernel methods in machine learning. Again, all of this comes about by this dual problem formulation of the original support vector machine training problems, which we encountered in the last hour. Now, Okay, so for maybe in the last, in the next 15 minutes or so, I basically point you to how you can go about studying why this works. So if you feel like studying why you can do this and why this exists, although it's not exam relevant and it's not even an exercise that you need to submit, if you nevertheless want to study that, maybe because you want to be a kernel researcher, which you don't want to be because you want to be a deep learning researcher, in any case, I will show you now how that works, and the good or roughly how that works, and the good thing is that on the way you learn about, or you, if you would study that in detail, you would learn about constraint optimization, which is of course a very general field. So the thing is to go from here to this dual problem, and of course for this one needs to be familiar with the notion of constraint optimization, dual problems, and then one is almost there. So to this I jump now to the optimization lecture, and which this is still all based on numerical optimization by Nutzer and Wright. And you also find a lot of this in here. You don't find that much of nonlinear constraint optimization in here, but you find other things in here. We already talked, when we talked about optimization, about unconstrained optimization, definitions and algorithm. And to get into this dual problem idea, one needs to talk about constraint optimization. And the bottom line is that of a constraint optimization problem, which is the aim of minimizing some function while with respect to some x. This x was our weights in the SVM problem, subject to certain constraints, and you can have two kinds of constraints, namely some function of the axis should be equal to something, and then you can always reformulate it as being equal to zero, so you have some equality constraints, and this is also the case for support vector machines, the problem some inequality constraints, so some functions of the thing of your parameter with regard to which you want to minimize your function fulfills certain inequalities, which you can also of course always reformulate as being larger or equal to zero. Because if it's the other way around, then you multiply everything by minus one, and if it's non-zero, then you subtract that from the right side, and then you have a different function, but it's still there. So that's the general problem of constraint optimization, which is of course a little bit more advanced than the unconstrained optimization problem. Unconstrained is just minimize f with respect to x. Constraint is the x should fulfill certain criteria. And be what is referred to in a feasible set. Constraint optimization, however, also in numerical maximum likelihood estimation, is not that uncommon. So, for example, if you think about the parameters of a Gaussian, which you might want to estimate using some numerical optimization, I'm thinking of you, Sarah, then the variance parameter needs to be larger or equal to zero, because otherwise it's not defined for Gaussian. So you have the constraint on this parameter actually that it's larger or equal to zero, so the function of this parameter, so the CI here, would just be the identity function, but kind of these bounded parameter spaces that you often encounter in actually practical application, even in computational cognitive neuroscience, and not only in high throughput machine learning, high performance computing, deep learning approaches, so bounded parameter spaces are quite natural in probabilistic models, because parameters of probability distributions usually have certain constraints associated with them. They are then the topic of constraint optimization. And in unconstrained optimization, where you have these first order necessary conditions for minima, so that the first derivative is zero, or the gradient equals the zero vector for a maximum or minimum, and you try to find, so you basically shift around your parameter of your objective function until such a constraint is satisfied, you can establish similar necessary conditions for constraint minimizers. So instead of looking for x values that only fulfill the scenario that the first derivative of your objective function is zero, you now look for values that go into the objective function or parameters of the objective function x's that fulfill analogous first order conditions, like the first derivative being of the function being zero, but they become a little bit more involved, so that they of course also for that they on the one hand actually are a minimum of this function, but at the other hand also fulfill this equality and inequality criteria. And these conditions are referred to as Karosh-Kuhn Tucker conditions, as we will see in a second. Before that, a quadratic program is just a special constraint optimization problem where the minimization function has this form. So it's xt times a matrix times x, so that's where the square comes in, a linear term, and then you have linear equality and inequality constraints. That's then what is referred to as a quadratic program, and it's of course a little bit simpler than the general case, because this could be any function that is twice differentiable and multivariately valued. Here you have a nice convex form, and these equality and inequality constraints, they of course can also be quite complicated, and here you have fairly straightforward linear constraints. So this is a quadratic program, it's just a special constraint optimization problem. And then there are libraries that can help you solve quadratic programs. To establish the conditions, the necessary conditions for a minimum of a inner constraint optimization problem, one needs what is called the Lagrangian function. And the Lagrangian function is associated with a constraint optimization problem and is defined as, if you have such a constraint optimization function, as a function of the original parameters of your optimization problems, so our weights in the SVM case, and so-called Lagrange multipliers. And these are the lambdas that then also show up in the dual problem formulation of the SVM training problem. And the Lagrangian function is defined as the objective function that you're interested in, and the sum of the multiple of these Lagrange multipliers with each constraint function over all equality and inequality constraints. And we can think long and can think a long time about why this is a good definition. The pragmatic view to view the Lagrangian function is that if you define this Lagrangian function and the Lagrange multipliers, then you can give the necessary condition for a constraint minimum in terms of the Karosh-Kuhn-Tucker conditions, because they involve the Lagrangian function. So the Lagrangian is crucial for the necessary conditions for constraint minimizers. And the same thing goes for Lagrange multiplier. So these Karosh-Kuhn-Tucker conditions here, Karosh-Kuhn-Tucker, I guess, they are like at a location, at a minimum, x star of this function, the derivative of the function is zero. Now, for a constraint problem, at a location of a minimum of this function and this location satisfying the constraints, so being in the feasible set, these conditions hold. Namely, that the gradient of the Lagrangian function with respect to x is zero. So that's essentially saying that the first derivative of your objective function is zero. The equality conditions are satisfied. The inequality conditions are satisfied. Well, that's what you want. So that basically just means that x star is actually a feasible point, so it satisfies the constraint. But then also that the Lagrange multipliers are larger or equal than zero for all inequality constraint, and that the product of the Lagrange multipliers and the constraint functions at this location x star, is zero for all equality and inequality constraints. This actually implies that because this is always larger than or equal to zero, that if it's actually, if you have a Lagrange multiplier that is actually larger than zero, then the inequality or equality constraint evaluates to zero. Yeah. So this means, in terms of the inequality constraints, this means that they are inactive or active. I don't know what the term is. But so these this fact also says something more specific about the x star in relation to the inequality constraints. So this is these are just first order necessary conditions. So you might remember that there are also second order necessary conditions in the unconstrained problem, which refer then to the to the second order derivatives, so that the second order derivative is larger than zero for minimum, and so on. And this also exists for constraint optimization, I just don't include it here. And there are also sufficient conditions, like you know, also from the case of simple minimization, that if it's larger than zero, and so if the second derivative is non-zero, and for example larger than zero, and the first derivative is zero, then there is a minimum. And these kind of sufficient conditions also exist in constraint optimization. I just don't include them here, but you can read all about them in the Notzetal book. The reason I don't include them here is because for duality you only we only need what we've seen so far. So the dual problem to minimize a function f subject to some inequality constraint is actually formulated in terms of the dual objective function. The dual objective function is given is a function actually of the Lagrangian multipliers, and is defined as the minimum of the Lagrangian function with respect to the original parameters. And then the dual problem to minimizing f of x subject to this is maximizing q lambda subject to the Lagrange multipliers being larger or equal to zero. This is actually what we've seen also in the SVM reformulation. Now, why would one start with the dual problem in the first of all? Of course, the idea would be that solving the dual problem is easier than solving the original or primal problem, and that, of course, the solution of the dual problem tells us something about the solution of the primal problem. Yeah, if the solution of the dual problem has no relation to the primal problem, and our primal problem is our actual problem, then the dual problem doesn't help. So there are two statements on the relationship between the solution of the dual problem and the solution of the primal problem. There's weak duality that says that the optimal value of the dual problem is a lower bound, that's a typo, on the optimal objective value for the primal problem. That's nice, but what is more important is that there's also strong duality, namely that the optimal Lagrange multipliers for the primal problem are solutions of the dual problem. So the solutions, on the other way around, the solutions of the dual problem are the optimal Lagrange multipliers for the primal problem. That's the strong duality. So this then really relates the, and helps you in when solving the dual problem to come up with solutions for your primal problem. And we of course seen one of the computational aspects of that for SVMs. In there we only need the scalar products of all feature vector pairs and not the feature vectors themselves. So in terms of memory demands, for example, if you think about storing 100,000 dimensional vectors in working memory and let the algorithm work on them, or storing, so that would be 1,000 times 100 values versus just storing 1,000 values, namely the dot products. That's of course more memory efficient. This is also proven here. Thing is, this we're just obviously we're doing it quite quickly right now. So there are the notions of constraints optimization problems and their dual problems, which sometimes help to solve the problems. What we haven't addressed at all yet are algorithms. Remember that there were algorithms for doing unconstrained optimizations like gradient descent and Newton methods. For constraint optimization, these methods essentially exist as well, but of course need to also account for the fact that there are these constraints. So for example, if you could do gradient descent and then you run into a boundary of your constrained parameter space, then of course you need to tell the algorithm what it's supposed to do. And then the idea is, well, then it should stop there, not go further into somewhere where the parameter space ends, but turn back and do something in the feasible region. And just here I just list some methods that you always find in the context of constraint optimization algorithms, for example active set methods, interior point methods, the augmented Lagrangian method, but also things that you sound more familiar like conjugate gradient methods, gradient methods, or extensions of the simplex algorithm. The simplex algorithm not being the Nelda-Mead simplex approach, but the original linear programming simplex. In terms of Python and doing constraint optimization, there are various toolboxes for this: SciPy Optimize, CVXOpt, and Mystic. These are actually links to the ones. And you know my personal approach of we don't use toolboxes. We only use toolboxes when I say so, and I say so. We use toolboxes for optimization, because otherwise we would have to do too much stuff in terms of optimization ourselves, and in the end we also need to make contributions to cognitive neuroscience. Good, so this was basically a rough, very rough tour, a very very rough and very very brief tour, not even a tour, it was more being at one point somewhere in the sea of constraint optimization and looking at the closest vicinity there. So it was not a tour, you just were dropped into constraint optimization at one location like in Google Earth, and then you looked around at the pictures that you can see from there and you see something, but you don't have an overview or anything. But that's how it is. But read the books if you are interested in that. The thing is, these things that I just introduced, they are actually enough to go about this reformulation of the dual problem of the maximum margin SVM training problem. So and this is what you find on these slides. So I go step by step. So if I want to do look at the dual problem, I obviously first need the Lagrangian function, and then I need the minimum of the Lagrangian function with respect to x, because that's how the dual problem is formulated. So first I formulate the Lagrangian function for the prime problem, that's what I do here. Then I evaluate the dual objective function by minimizing the Lagrangian function with respect to the parameters, namely the weight parameters, so W and W0. This can be done analytically and results in a minimum for the weight vector and a condition for the bias vector, And then this can be actually substituted into the dual objective function. So here it's the problem of minimizing the Lagrangian, and then of course it's defined as the minimum of the Lagrangian, not as the minimizing parameters or something. So it's the minimum of the Lagrangian. So if you know the minimum parameters, you can just substitute them into the Lagrangian. This is what I'm doing here, and then you do voila 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 voila, and then in the end you get to this dual objective function that we've seen on the earlier slide, which involves these dot products. Yeah, so this is where these dot products come from. They come from evaluating the dual objective function for a constraint optimization problem. Thing is, then you have the dual objective function. That's nice, and you can write down the dual problem. What you can also then already do is formulate this whole thing as a quadratic programming problem. That's nice. Then you get the can put it into a toolbox, get the optimal Lagrange multipliers, or you write your own constraint optimization problem, constraint optimization solver. The problem that you then have, that what you get are the optimal Lagrange multipliers, and the optimal Lagrange multipliers are related to your optimal weight parameters, but they are not the optimal weight parameters, and they are not the optimal bias parameter. So what you also need is a formula that allow you to translate the solution of the dual problem, namely your optimal Lagrange multipliers, into the solution of the primal problem, namely optimal weight and bias parameters. And these are then derived here by again looking at the minimization formulas that involve the a relationship between the Lagrange multipliers and the weight parameters. And if you put in the optimal Lagrange multipliers, you get the optimal weight parameters. So you have the this for the weight and for the bias. You need to do a little bit more, but then you get to the solution that you basically have this formula to get the optimal bias. And then for framing this quadratic program, you just need to make sure that you formulate the matrices the right way. So that's in kind of 35 minutes basically an explanation via nonlinear constraint programming to explain where this reformulation comes from. But this is, again, this is more a technical issue, and we wouldn't really need to talk about this at all from our perspective if this technical issue wouldn't be also the motivation for kernel methods. And if you look into SVMs in books, you will often find this without any explanation. So this is why I explain it here. But again, it's not exam relevant. It's for people that want to go deeper into support vector machines. And maybe I can almost recommend to go into support vector machines. Just call it deep SVMs, or I think deep SVMs already exist. But then do deep SVMs applied to brain imaging data, and maybe you're lucky and this will be the next big thing. Actually, it's not so much about being lucky, it's more that you push it, that you do a public, that you set up a website, that you send emails to everyone, that you organize a workshop, that so that you do a PR campaign for this, and then it will be the next big thing. But maybe talk to some PR company first to make sure that this works, and even then it might not work, as you know, with PR. Good. So that was that. And I think that was what I wanted to do today. So scrolling back and going back to the beginning, of course, support vector machines are being used for classification and to come up with, in the end, these kind of results. Actually, these results were from a support vector machine, linear support vector machine with some C value that you will find somewhere in the paper. And of course, support vector machines are also used for searchlight analysis and so on. But again, keep in mind that what we looked into here was coming up with decision boundaries based on training data, and basically this step where you put from an applied perspective the things into the toolbox, and then the toolbox does the training, and then you give it some test data, and you what you then compute again is averaging the accuracy of the prediction. So we basically looked under the hood there. And this was SVMs, and then next time would be linear discriminant, then logistic regression, and then neural networks. Yeah, maybe as a preemptive thing in terms of what is best, it depends. And there, I think there are some papers that look at brain imaging and classification. I think, I mean, the question is what also the question is really what you mean by best. And if you mean by best the understanding how the brain works, then I would say throw away all this classification madness and go to biophysical and cognitive modeling of fMRI. Data and EEG data, because that's where you actually need to invent how the brain works and need to think about how the brain works. So if best means understanding the brain, this is definitely crap. If best means getting good prediction and high classification accuracy, which is not necessary or doesn't have anything to do with understanding how the brain works, then of course it depends on the distribution of the data, on the dimensionality of your problems, how many features you have, and then certain classification methods may be better than others in certain applied scenarios. And there you also find some, I think there are some new imaging papers that compare different classification techniques in certain imaging scenarios. Yeah, in the end, they are all with this classification on the wrong track. And if they're using this for basic science, if they're using this for clinical applications and for the purpose of not understanding how the brain works, but to make predictions that help mankind irrespective of how things work, then they're of course on the right track. But most of the time, people use these classification methods with the aim of basic research, and this I think is highly misled. But I should really write a comment for some of these high profile journals on this at one point, because nobody seems to get it. Anyway, good. So, any questions? Okay, so no questions, and then we will return to the question of classified training next time with two different models, namely linear discriminant and logistic regression models, which again involve some probability, so they are a little bit nicer than SVMs. And then in the last session, also look at a different form of classifiers, namely deep neural networks, which means they have more than one hidden layer, then they are deep. Okay, final thing, as I already sent around an email earlier this morning, we will start with the programming already at 12:30, and then we are done a little bit earlier. And I don't have anything right now to do in the break, so we can start earlier. Good, then see you in a bit.